thank you all very, very much for being here today. I appreciate it. Thank you for thank you for the introduction, Linda. I do appreciate that she kept that a little bit short. Recently, things have been moving fast. You know, she mentioned 60 Minutes. She mentioned some of the things you're doing. I already case the Supreme Court in December. And there's been so much going on that sometimes you forget about some of the things. So when you hear those introductions, it reminds me of some of the things that maybe I should mention and talk about. As some of you know, I pride myself on never giving the same speech twice and never preparing my speeches ahead of time, which when I'm in a room like this is sometimes a little scary. So please take it easy on me. I will tell you that I did notice, and I mentioned to your Bay County Attorney Sheila Polk, that my jacket's a little bit tight today, and I'm not sure if that's because the dry cleaner shrunk it or if I'm gaining weight while I'm in office now. So but I have committed, and I've told my wife that I'm going on the Barack Obama diet. And for those of you who don't know what that is, that's where you basically let Vladimir Putin eat your lunch every day. That's a Brno original. If you hear Rubio using that, speaking of Rubio, I just want to remind all the friends from Chicago, you can only vote once in the straw poll. So, once again, I thank you. I remember being here. I was going to say last year, but gosh, it's been 2 years since I had the opportunity to speak in front of y'all, and I just want to say thank you. This is, I remember at that time, I think I started by saying something that, you know, I love Yavapai County, Yavapai County's love me back. And, you know, growing up here in Arizona, I have so many fond memories of everything from hiking Thumb Butte to going up, you know, to Sedona, and driving to Dewey, all that. And so it's so great to be here and to see so many old and new friends. In fact, I was about to talk about some of the people that are in this room that I've known for years, and some of the people that have been very supportive of me in my race when I was the underdog. And but I'm afraid that once you start naming somebody, you'll be remiss and miss somebody. So let me just say thank you from the bottom of my heart to everyone here in Yavapai County and for folks in Verde Valley from all over, because I really, really, and truly blessed. And without your support in this room, I wouldn't be the Attorney General today. So thank you. Let me just say thank you all very, very much. Come on, Mr. Now, as the Attorney General, one of the questions, it's funny, shortly after the election, my sister-in-law had asked me, what exactly does the Attorney General do? And I realized that sometimes people don't fully appreciate the important role the Attorney General plays sometimes in our lives every day. The Attorney General is the state's chief law enforcement officer. She not only works on criminal cases, but civil cases as well. When I became Attorney General, one of the things that I did as someone who used to work there is we revamped the agency a little bit and consolidated some of the divisions. So we have 7 basic divisions in the office that do everything, as I said, from civil to criminal to administrative to appearing in courts, appellate courts representing the state. But first and foremost, our Solicitor General. The Solicitor General in his office argues cases, everything from cases that go through the Supreme Court to our appellate courts. In fact, our Solicitor General himself today is in court arguing a case involving a medical doctor and whether the state can move forward on prosecuting a doctor for prescribing marijuana without allegedly seeing the patients. One of the things about initiatives, and I know we're going to have a lot of initiatives this year again, is you always need to be really, really careful when you vote yes on something. Because once you do, it locks in the state a law, and the legislature can't change it. They can only, by 3/4 vote, do something in favor of it. So, for example, with the medical marijuana initiative, we know there's been unintended consequences. We were told, we were sold that it was going to be there to help patients that are terminally ill, patients that have chronic diseases and illness. But instead, what we've seen is the stats have borne out, is that most of the people getting medical marijuana cards are males 35 and under. So I realize we had so many skateboarders here in Arizona, but I'm not trying to make fun of people eating cards, but most of, an overwhelming majority of the prescriptions for medical marijuana are being written by naturopaths. They're not even medical doctors. You know, these aren't oncologists or surgeons or people that are dealing with people with terminal illnesses or chronic suffering. That's not to say that maybe there are some benefits, but my point is that when you vote yes on something, there are always unintended consequences. You can't fix them. And one of the cases we are right now today arguing at our state Supreme Court is whether you can prosecute a doctor for allegedly misprescribing medical marijuana when he hasn't even seen the patients. And I say that because the case was dismissed at the county level. In Navajo County, the case was dismissed because the court said that when voters approved medical marijuana, they wanted to make sure that doctors were not liable for prescribing it. So, of course, our position is that if someone's engaging in fraud or forgery, miswriting prescriptions or falsifying records, they should be held accountable to the law, whether voters approve medical marijuana or not. So. And I'm going to touch a little bit more on another function of the Solicitor General's office that we started at the Federalist Meeting. I also want to talk about some of the other divisions. Our civil division. Our civil division is involved in everything from civil rights issues to consumer complaints. This first year, my first year as Attorney General, we have received more than 16,000 consumer complaints, a great increase from the previous year. And I think that's important. We have folks that are out in the community, whether it's seniors, vulnerable adults, older kids, getting the message out. And if you've been scammed, if some crook, if some con man, if someone took advantage of you, there's a place to go, and it's the Arizona Attorney General's office. You may have seen recently stories, everything from our agents going in after we received complaints from our consumer line, going in and doing undercover investigations of auto mechanics, that were basically mischarging people and stealing from consumers, going after people down in southern Arizona that were involved in stealing the checkbook and finances, I guess I should say allegedly stealing the finances from I don't want to get sued, from a vulnerable adult, from someone elderly. And so when I was running, many of you were in the room when I came here to talk about what we were going to do, and I said, we're going to protect the most vulnerable, and we're gonna push back against federal overreach. And if you look at what our civil division is doing when it comes to consumer protection and going after, as I said, scammers, crooks, and cheats, we are truly being much more aggressive in protecting those that can't always fight back. Of course, we have a criminal division. The county prosecutors are the chief line when it comes to most criminal cases. But there are cases involving everything you may have seen where we took on a case involving someone that was illegally selling human body parts. And we took that case on. We've also taken on cases involving the cartels and organizations that smuggle drugs and people into our country. We want to make sure they're doing everything we can to fight back against those that are committing and undermining our quality of life here in Arizona. And that's some of the things our criminal division is doing. We also have a child and family division that deals with representing state agencies and deals with the crisis, and it is a crisis, I would submit to you, that we have in our child care system. Right now, there's about 17,000 kids in foster care. Our lawyers, just last year, my first year in office, made 88,000, well, actually more than 88,000 court appearances related to child and family matters. Now think about that. Right now, in fact, our budget, we put in a budget request to get more lawyers, more resources. Our lawyers right now are handling 2.5 times the recommended caseload that they're supposed to be handling. And we want to make sure that we're doing everything we can to not only represent the clients, to make sure we're doing everything we can to protect those kids who sometimes don't have a voice and interests aren't always looked at. We also have a state government division, an agency council division, which represents more than 200 agencies, boards, commissions, committees, providing them legal advice. I will tell you, one of the things that I'm most proud of is that right now we are representing more agencies and more boards where they don't have to use outside counsel than ever before, more than when I took office. I'm very proud of that, because if our lawyers are able to handle that counsel representation and represent the agencies and the boards, guess what that means? That means that they aren't spending hardworking taxpayer dollars to hire lawyers from outside firms. And so I wanted to make sure that's something that we did in our office as well. As you can see, we're very, very busy. There's a lot going on. And I want to highlight just a couple of the few key cases that we're working on right now. One of the things, as I said earlier when I ran, I was talking about we're going to protect the most vulnerable, and we're also going to push back against the overreach of the federal government when necessary. And so you may have seen that we have been involved with or initiated several lawsuits over the course of my first year. So whether it's fighting back against the overreach of the Obama administration and their job-killing regulations like the 111D, the 111B carbon rules, the ozone rules that have been promulgated, where we're the lead state on that, representing several other states in filing lawsuits that challenge the EPA and what they are doing. I will tell you, I grew up here in Arizona. I'm a member of the state's Parks Board. I love clean air, I love clean water. I want to preserve this, I want to hand this down for our future generations. But I will tell you today, so much of what's going on with environmental regulations is not about protecting the environment, but it's about trying to control our economic destinies and control our property. In fact, maybe I should. I would submit to you that when the Soviet Union collapsed, communism didn't go away, they just all ended up in the environmental movement. It's true, when I sat down for an editorial board meeting last year, and I talked about the fact that we need to be more engaged. People talk about, oh, I'm gonna do X, Y, or Z, or I'm gonna sue the federal government, but what do they actually do? They need to really be truly engaged, and that's one of the reasons why we created this federalism unit. And so we have initiated these lawsuits, the environmental regulations, and one of the editors asked me about it. And they're like, aren't you wasting a bunch of time and money? And I said, well, I'll tell you what, you go talk to the folks up in, you know, Indian country, up in Navajo, talk to the Hopi, where so much, there's a high unemployment rates and so much of their employment and their tribal revenues are dependent on mining, energy production. Go talk to people like my mother, her friends, the retirees out that live on fixed incomes. When their electric rates are gonna go up 15 to 20% as a result of these new regulations, you go tell them it's a waste of time. Go talk to the small business owners, the folks at the National Federation of Independent Businesses. They're gonna have to pass on increased costs, including water costs, because in Arizona, it takes electricity to move water. When your utility and your water rates go up, you go tell them that's a waste of time and money. And ultimately, when you look at these regulations, even according to the estimates of the Obama administration itself, according to their own modeling, they will have a 0.02 degree impact on temperatures over the next 75 years. So we're gonna dismantle our whole entire economy. I mean, we're already dismantling the military. Now we're gonna dismantle the economy because of someone says we're gonna have this negligible impact overall on temperatures. I say no, I say those are fights worth having. And so that's why we're involved in it. And related to that, there's a lawsuit you may have seen that we joined. Actually, there's two lawsuits involving the reintroduction of the Mexican gray wolf. This is something that we've seen where you have environmentalists use the Endangered Species Act to try to get species listed, and then they try to protect their territory, and ultimately they can have an impact on how land develops and what happens with it. And so we wanted to be very, very proactive. Because for years, what has happened is the environmentalists will file a lawsuit, and then they sit down with the federal government and sympathetic folks of the federal government, and they come up with a settlement, and we get left out. And that's why I thought it was so important as a state that we intervene and we get involved in that litigation. And when someone asked me recently about why we got involved, the first thing I thought of was that when I was a kid growing up here down in Phoenix, I remember reading the story of Little Red Riding Hood and the Big Bad Wolf. Some of you may remember that story. And I said, if that story was written today, we'd have to tell our kids that that wolf would be accompanied by lobbyists, lawyers, environmentalists, federal bureaucrats. Because God knows who needs to get to the house safely, right? And so, you know, once again, I am all for protecting our environment and our resources. But you know what? We have to coexist, and we have to do this in a very reasonable way. And that's why we've been involved in so much of that litigation. The other things that we've been doing over this past year you may have seen is we had arguments recently this few months back dealing with the issue of whether the state had to or could deny driver's licenses to people that were in the country illegally. And I will tell you what I said to the reporters and everyone else about that case. That case is not about immigration. It's not about whether the state should or shouldn't give driver's license to a group of people. I mean, ultimately, I think that's an issue that's left up to the states. But here's the hypocrisy of what's going on right now in Washington, D.C., and why so many of us are so disgusted by everything. The Obama administration in the Fifth Circuit, there's a lawsuit right now that Arizona and 26 states sued the federal government over their deferred action program. And as a result of that, the Obama administration filed a response trying to get that lawsuit removed in Texas and the Fifth Circuit. It may end up at the Supreme Court. In fact, there's writs right now, certiorari, whether the Supreme Court will hear it. In that Fifth Circuit case, the Obama administration took the position that states are not required. They have the discretion. There's no harm to the state because they have the discretion whether to issue driver's license or not. But here in our case, in Arizona, when it was argued at the Ninth Circuit, that the federal government, the Department of Justice took the position that we had to get driver's license. There was a violation of the Constitution, Equal Protection Clause, if we didn't. And so to me, that fight is not about immigration. It's not about the policy, whether you should or shouldn't get driver's license. It is about whether the state and the government have the authority and the discretion to make that decision, or whether some president or unelected bureaucrat gets to dictate to us how we should control what has traditionally been a state function, and that is issuing a driver's license. So it has been, it has been a very, very busy year. But these are, actually, those guys didn't mind. Oh, Greg Lizell, what are you leaving for? Sorry, I'm gonna get in trouble now. I do know Greg from college, so I can, I've got lots of stories, so it's mutually assured destruction. Yes, I'm sorry, I apologize. I probably will get hate mail now. Anyway, join the list, buddy. But I think it is so important for us to be engaged, because I will tell you, as you heard in the introduction, you know, my family, my roots are in the former Eastern Europe, and my mother lived through the horrors of World War II, lived through communism. And when you have that background, you have a great appreciation and love for what America is all about. We truly are the shining city on the hill. The people all over the world, whether we know it or not, look to us for guidance, look to us for help. And that's why when we withdraw as a country from the world, it's not that nothing fills it, but ultimately something will fill it. And what we have seen is radical Islamists that mean us harm are filling that void. And I have a lot of friends. I know John Palladini, him and I were in the National Guard together. He's still in the military. I have a lot of friends that served in Iraq and Afghanistan. And I will tell you, to me, it's a shame that what happened to places like Iraq after that country was stabilized is that we just basically pulled out and didn't leave any forces behind. Whether you were for or against that war, it was stabilized. And for us to withdraw now, what we've done is create a vacuum and given our enemies territory that they can ultimately control. And so we are in a generational fight. We are in a fight, I think, for the very survival of what the United States means, but not only internationally, but here domestically. What we have seen is more and more a concentration of power in unelected bureaucrats and folks from Washington, D.C. And that's one of the reasons why I always said, and what we've done, is we need to make sure that we're vigilant, that we're pushing back against the overreach of the federal government, regardless of what the party is. Because as Ronald Reagan said, it wasn't the federal government that created the states. It was the states that created the federal government. And we need to recognize and get back to that. And I guess let me just close by saying this. We had that beautiful video of President Reagan, and I love President Reagan. I mean, everything he did, especially standing up, speaking truth to power, to what was going on with the Soviet Union. Some of you may remember when President Reagan called the Soviet Union the evil empire in the 1980s. People were like, oh my gosh, he can't do that. He's gonna lead to a war. But you know what, he proved that when you're strong, people will respect you. And ultimately, because of the actions of what Ronald Reagan did, I would submit to you, that's the reason why the Berlin Wall ultimately fell. But I will tell you, one of the things that Ronald Reagan said that I love and I try to live with and we try to instill is President Reagan said that we are never more than one generation away from losing our freedoms. It's something that we don't pass on to our kids in the blood. It's something that we must protect, nurture, defend, and pass on. And so that's the way I look at my job every day. I think that what I'm doing not for myself. Frankly, I'm doing it for my kids, for your kids, and their kids, to leave this a better place than we found it. And that's what I think ultimately being a good servant and being a good steward is all about. So I thank all of you that have been with me from the beginning. And for those of you that haven't, I just want you to know I'm working hard every day to make sure that we truly are the greatest state in the union. So thank you all for that.
You have
just stare down at the person?
No.
Yes, we do still have a satellite office up here. One of the things, I want to make sure that I'm not the Attorney General just for the state of Maricopa. And so we really have tried to make an effort. Sometimes it's tough, but I'll be back up here again next month. Like I said, I've got a lot of friends, a lot of people up here that I really enjoy spending time with. And so we want to make sure we're doing everything we can to make sure all of Arizona is represented, regardless of where you live or where you're from. Let me just add one caveat to that. One of the things that when I became AG, I met with every one of our divisions. I mentioned those divisions earlier. I told them that, look, we're the people's law firm. We're the lawyers of the state of Arizona. What that means is that we measure success not in whether we win or lose in the courtroom or how many cases we win. We measure success in terms of, has justice been done? That's always the question we need to ask, is has justice been done? And so, for example, in our liability management section, our lawyers that defend the state of Arizona litigation, I reminded them, I said, look, we are not State Farm, we're not all state, we're the state of Arizona. And so what that means is that when the state does something wrong, we need to find a resolution. And so I know that, especially up here in Yavapai County, our office, after I became AG, I said, we need to do right by the victims, we need to do right by the public, let's figure out a way to settle lawsuits involving the firefighters and the tragic that occurred in Yarnell on the Hill. And so we actually have settled that case. We worked with the plaintiff's lawyers, we settled that case with a resolution that the victims' families were satisfied with. But also, you may see that in the governor's budget, there is more equipment there's money for equipment, radios, communications, additional fire truck, and that's a result of that settlement. So I'm not a policymaker, but I do think that as the state's lawyer, there are times when you say, let's do right by the people and not worry about fighting something and dragging everybody through that. So thank you. Yes.
Ladies first.
Thank you. And thank you for coming up here to speak with all of us. Republican Women of Prescott has voted on and signed the resolution against the legalization of recreational marijuana, which, as we know, will be on the ballot in 2016 because it will harm our children. This weekend, Yavapai County GOP voted on the same resolution against the legalization of recreational marijuana, as did Maricopa County GOP. As the chief law enforcement officer, what is your stand on the legalization of recreational marijuana?
I haven't even answered the question yet. You may not like it. No, I will tell you, this is an issue that we're studying very, very carefully. And there's a couple things. One is it has not qualified for the ballot yet. And very often when something does end up qualifying, there are disputes over everything from the signatures gathered to language, the ballot language, that our office may be involved in having one way or another in litigation. So I do that caveat. And then I'll also say, as I said earlier in my opening remarks, I think we need to be very, very careful about whenever we vote on any initiative. The initiative process, as you know, was designed to let the people bypass the legislature and government and to provide them a voice. My concern is that too often the legislative or the initiative process has been used to create legislation that people don't fully understand and there's unintended consequences. So if you look at what happened, for example, medical marijuana, there are all these unintended consequences. And I worry that there's so much focus right now on stopping the recreational or the legalization of marijuana that everyone's forgotten about or not focusing enough energy on what's going on with medical marijuana. Because quite frankly, I will tell you, the medical marijuana is essentially backdoor legalization. And what we see is I think it sends a terrible message to our kids. And ultimately, that's what I want to do. I want to do right by, as I said, by my kids and their kids. I don't want to experiment with our kids. I mean, right now it's been legalized in Colorado, it's been legalized in Washington. I don't know why we're rushing into this. I think we should take a wait and see approach, see what happens in other states, and then we can sit down and make a deliberate decision as Arizonans whether this is right or best for us. But I will tell you that the medical marijuana question, I think not enough people are talking about, and that to me is a real danger. I've seen studies and polls right now that show that, you know, teenagers think marijuana is safer than cigarettes, tobacco, liquor. And why is that? I will tell you, and I'll tell you a story right now. I was driving with one of my kids, one of my teenage daughters. And she asked me, she said, "Dad, you always say the drugs are terrible, marijuana is bad for you. If it's so bad, why are they selling it at these, the Green Cross places? How can medicine be bad for you? Is it just bad if you misuse it?" And so I think by calling it medicine, we're actually sending a terrible message. And that's what I think we need to start addressing. So we can sit there and vote no on legalization, but ultimately we have a problem. We have a problem with the way medical marijuana is being distributed, who's writing prescriptions for it. And as I said, we have a case literally right now at the state Supreme Court where we're arguing over whether we can prosecute a doctor who basically allegedly falsified medical records so he could write a prescription for medical marijuana. And the fact that some naturopaths, and no disrespect to naturopaths, I mean, I don't know if there's any naturopaths, and I know they do a lot of value and a lot of good, but most of the prescriptions are being prescribed by people that are naturopaths. These aren't medical doctors. They aren't medically trained. So I think that there are a lot of other issues associated with this, and I think we need to be fully engaged as a state, even as the AG, in addressing this on a macro level, and that's what I plan on doing.
Mr. Brnovich, my name is Joe Pendergast, and last November, I wrote a letter to your office, to you. And then I called your office last Friday so that you would be familiar with the fact that I'd be asking the question today, since I received no answer to my letter. And I took your secretary, Elizabeth, and emailed another copy of your letter. So I hope you're ready to address this subject. What concerns? We have a local election here last November. It concerns.
Did you say last November? November 2015?
Yes.
Okay.
And it was done by mail-in ballots. 8 days before the ballots were closed, before the election day, the newspaper printed demographics regarding votes that had already been received.
Looks like the newspaper shut off the mic. The Lord works in mysterious ways.
There's only one place that these demographics could have come from, which was the county recorder's office, because she receives the ballots. Our question from the Citizens Tax Committee is the release of demographics before the polls are closed permitted, or should the county recorder be directed not to release any demographics before the polls are closed?
Well, I will tell you, I am a big believer in local control, and just as a state, we complain about what the federal government does, and unfunded mandates, when the federal government tries to interfere in state affairs. I also believe that as a state, we need to be very, very careful in interfering with charter cities or counties and second-guessing what they do. So, you may have seen recently, for example, we had issued a legal opinion we were asked for, which shared the same legal opinion as Maricopa County Attorney's Office regarding the assessor, for example, the county assessor. And that was something that we did not weigh into until it was absolutely necessary and we were asked to formally do so. So my first instinct on that question is that you have got one of the best county attorneys in the state of Arizona here, if you're sitting right next to me. Sheila, this sounds like a question for you. So anyway, but in all seriousness, as to the county recorder, very often county officials receive advice from the county attorney. And so I would say that I would defer to the county attorney as to what information the recorder may or may not issue or may or may not use. I will say, as I said at the very beginning, we get literally 16,000 complaints this last year, consumer, various complaints, various letters. And those are just formal ones. We get email, we get hit with a lot of other stuff. I have more than 450 lawyers that work for our office. As I said, last year, just in the child protective, not the criminal, but just in our child and family unit, our lawyers make more than 88,000 appearances. So our folks are working really hard with the limited resources we have. Last year, the legislature swept $31.5 million from our funds that were supposed to be meant, our office has been involved in litigation involving consumer fraud, consumer protection, you know, price fixing. It was supposed to be used for restitution and also to help us in our ability to reach out to victims. And so I feel like we do the best we can with the resources we've got. We've asked for more, but ultimately on something like that, I would defer to the county attorney as the first line of legal question or legal authority as to what the recorder may or may not do. And I'm sorry to put you on the spot, Sheila, but I'm sure she can discuss it with you offline afterwards.
I'll forward a copy to her office.
Thank you. I mean, I'm guessing you don't want the state second guessing what your county and city officials are doing, do you? I mean, I don't know. Yes. Billy Orr, yes, that is for you. Yes.
Thank you for coming today. I'm Dwight Kadar from Sedona. And I do appreciate the comments about federal overreach, but specifically, Arizona is under assault by this administration. Specifically, if President Obama were to use the Antiquities Act to designate 1.7 million acres of the Grand Canyon watershed, and 160,000 acres around Sedona is national monument, would you use Prop 122 to stop this federal overreach?
The issue of federal overreach, as I said, is something dear and near to my heart. Property rights are very near and dear to my heart. Some of you may remember, I thought last time I spoke or here, or one of the events up here in Yavapai County, I specifically talked about the Antiquities Act, which you know you may recall was 1906, gave the president the authority to preserve cultural and significant artifacts. What we've seen over the last couple of decades is that the federal government, the president, has used that to designate massive areas. So I actually had already on record wrote a letter already, signed a letter opposing that designation. I don't want to see the federal government basically taking land and making it so it can't be used for everything from recreational use to mining, to harvesting timber, basically taking it off the shelf and controlling that property. The question then becomes, well, what can we do besides writing letters and urging our congressional delegation to oppose it? And that might mean strict funding. It might mean that they can't do any more further designations than if they don't care of the designations that have already occurred. One of the things that's happening is that you've seen when they do these designations, they haven't even put the proper resources to protect them. So there's big folks out there that think, oh, if we designate something using the Antiquities Act, it may provide more protection. But that's not necessarily the case, because the federal government hasn't allocated those resources. I think that's an avenue, something we need to look at. And ultimately, I think that we need to just explore our possible litigation options, and if that means suing the federal government and whether the government has that authority. I've always thought it was interesting that no one has made this legal argument. There's been some challenges that have failed, but one of the things about the Antiquities Act is you're supposed to take as least amount of property as possible when you do that designation to preserve those cultural artifacts. Well, the question becomes, do you need to take in 1.6 million acres or sometimes hundreds of thousands of acres in order to preserve those artifacts? And so I think on a case-by-case basis, that's something we need to look at. That's something that we should be involved in at the litigation level. But once again, you know, we created the first ever federalism unit in our office, which is involved in several ongoing major litigations. I guess it's not litigations. But we're involved in litigation on several different fronts. And so we're looking forward, we need the resources we need to make sure that we're fighting. Because when it comes to this stuff, you've got the federal government, you've got environmental groups, they got all these lawyers, lobbyists, and so you know we're relying on the few lawyers we have that I've hired to go in there and take them on. And so if we have the resources we need, we're gonna do everything we can to push back against those designations.
Very quickly, there are two of us going to be presenting to Kelly Townsend's federalism and states' rights committee tomorrow morning, this exact issue representing Arizona Liberty from Sedona.
Thank you. Although I will say, for the record, one of my little pet peeves, I know some of you know I used to work at the Goldwater Institute, and I will tell you that I always like to say, states don't have rights, people have rights. And I think we need to be really sometimes careful when we argue these things, because we believe in federalism, we believe in the Constitution, but people have rights, not states.
Yes. Mary Beth, I'm going to hit you up for money here, so I'm going to put you on the spot. We have a big problem with the recovery home industry in this area, and Representative Noel Campbell just dropped a bill trying to register the homes. This has been a notoriously difficult industry to regulate because they've been known as a protected class, and the business model itself makes it very difficult to regulate. It's across the country, it's been very, very difficult to do so. And the legislation itself will allow the municipalities, if they so choose, to register the homes. So when Prescott gets slapped with what I see will be inevitable lawsuits, will your office come and help us defend those lawsuits?
I think I understand the issue you're talking about. You're talking about the homes for like drug treatment and some of the group homes and stuff. I had a meeting with the mayor and the city attorney earlier today, and this very issue came up. And it really depends. It depends on how the litigation proceeds, how it goes forward, whether there's a challenge to the state statute. We have an obligation to defend the state laws, the state statute, so we would have to be in there defending it. So at this point, it's a little speculative, and it just depends on the way the facts and circumstances develop and what happens as to what the law says, what ultimately is passed. And if there is a lawsuit, is there a suit that challenges the state statute? Is it just challenges the discretion the city used? So the reality, it's a tough question to answer if there's actually a lawsuit filed. But we do, as a state, us as an office, we have to defend state statutes. And so that is one of our charges. So I don't know what we're doing in other cases. Dobro, Svefino, Kakosti Ti. Ti pričas srpski? Dobro. My mama je rođen blizu Split. Old Home Week, yes.
Okay, if...
Just so we're clear, just because I speak Eastern European languages does not mean I'm a commie or a Russian spy.
Me neither.
Would there be as many foster homes if the government did not reward women to have one child after another?
Well, just so we're clear, I'm not rewarding anybody for having more kids, not even my wife. We have two beautiful daughters, and that's a handful. So, this is really, frankly, it's a bigger problem. There's a bigger question. The breakdown in the family has led to a lot of consequences, unintended consequences. We see what happened. If you read some of Charles Murray's stuff, books like Coming Apart, you'll realize that there's a crisis in this country as far as the breakdown of the family. I don't pretend I'm a lawyer. I don't pretend to know all the answers as to how to solve that. But I do think that, protecting families, protecting family values, trying to keep them intact is something I think that's ultimately important. Because when it comes to, you could rattle off the issues, drug abuse, low performance in schools, delinquency. A lot of this is tied, frankly, to the breakup of the family. And so I think that people need to have good models. I think that we should encourage, we should encourage work when it comes to a lot of welfare programs. I think that we should make sure we're doing everything we can that if someone's able-bodied, that they're trying to make a living for themselves. That being said, I think as a government, we have an obligation to protect the most vulnerable people in our society. And, some people are in circumstances to no fault of their own. And what we need to do is make sure we're there to give someone a hand up. Ultimately, I guess it's one of these things where, we want to make sure that, we protect people and there's that safety net, but we don't want it to become a permanent floor where people become permanently dependent on the government. There's people like Arthur Brooks, who recently wrote a book called The Road to Freedom. It's kind of a take on Hayek's book, The Road to Serfdom. And in The Road to Freedom, he talks a lot about the value and the dignity of hard work and the psychological benefits, not only financial, the psychological benefits of working and doing things for yourself. And so, these are big, big questions, and sometimes I feel like we're just putting a Band-Aid on it when it comes to some of these issues dealing with the breakdown of the family, our office, the stuff that we're involved in, Child Protective Services. But, it's going to require a bigger solution, a greater solution. And, and folks like this, the group here today, with everything you do to really reinforce our values, reinforce our culture, are really, quite frankly, an important step on the road to helping preserve our families.
Mr. Brnovich, we have two more questions, and one is in the back. We need to accommodate a lady, so she'll direct her question.
My question
Good morning, or good afternoon. My question, or my subject, is illegal immigrants. Now, Donald Trump has said he's going to build a wall that will be paid by the Mexicans. It doesn't make any difference who's going to pay for the wall. We do need a wall. And you do that, and I'd like to know if you would support Donald Trump in building a wall to keep out all these illegal immigrants that we have in Arizona.
Well, I wonder, I guess my first response is he building the wall just on the southern border or the northern border as well? So, I will tell you that we are a nation of immigrants, and I think, quite frankly, immigration reform is something that we need to look at as a country. I think that the Democrats control Congress, they control the House of Representatives, the Senate, and the White House for the first 2 years of the Obama administration, had a supermajority, and they did nothing on this issue. But now they're doing all sorts of stuff. Why? Because of politics. And this issue's been politicized. I think that we can't have any discussion on immigration reform until we secure our border, and we gotta figure out who's here first, not because it's an immigration issue, it's a national security issue. I know we are dealing with cases, and I've seen cases where there's folks that are coming from all sorts of places, including the Middle East, through our southern border. We do know that in the past, things like Operation Streamline, where there was a concentration and an effort by federal prosecutors and border secure people to close down and shut down certain segments of the border, worked. We saw it working, and you saw a decline in people trying to get into the country illegally. So we know that the ability is there. Going to stuff like E-Verify, enforcing workplace and making sure that folks are only hiring people that are here illegally, enforcing the laws that we have right now. I think that would solve a lot of the problem. The problem is that you have a federal government that's either unwilling or unable to do so. But we know that it exists, means exist to do it. We also know that you can build a virtual fence. You can use electronics, technology, things that are being used right now in the Middle East and Saudi Arabia or Iraq to basically create a virtual or electronic fence to know every time someone crosses that barrier, you're able to do that. So the technology exists to do this. And so to me, this is about, we could build the greatest wall in the world, but if you don't have an executive, if you don't have a federal government that's willing to enforce the law, it doesn't matter. Because they can just look the other way. Elections have consequences, and that's why we need to make sure we elect a president whose first priority is enforcing the rule of law. As I said, to me, this is about the rule of law. It's not about immigration reform at this point, because we can secure the border, we can do that, the federal government can, and once we do that, we need to have a meaningful conversation in this country as to what immigration will look like in the future. But I don't think anyone wants to go anywhere until we secure that border.
Hi, Mr. Brnovich, I am the county reporter, I'm Leslie Hoffman. Mr. Pendergast, the report that you were speaking about, the article that came out, I did not put that in the paper, but by state law, the county reporter is required to release certain figures to parties prior to an election. It's not a lot of the demographics that were in that article. It is who has cast a ballot, what ballots are in the number, but not a lot of those demographics. So we did not release them. What we did release is what we're required to by state law.
Thank you. There's the answer to that question. I could have used that 10 minutes ago, but apparently there's a debate going on now, so showed up for a speech and debate broke out. That's this is kind of bad influence I am. So let me just say, thank you all. Is there another question? Okay. Thank you all very, very much. Thank you for being here. Seriously, God bless you all so much, and I cannot tell you how much I love being here, and thank you, thank you, thank you.